please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Okay, start of last hour on what we are calling the election budget, and of course the market has been very volatile. It tanked immediately after the budget because of that long-term capital gains tax. After that, there was massive recovery, massive rally intraday, and that rally is being sold into. So, interesting last hour lined up. Hi, Surabhi. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Anuj. It's a roller coaster, right? Budget
yes.
days promise to always bring some excitement, and this one has ensured that that happens. But as you're saying, there's an interesting dichotomy. I mean, you know, global markets have been okay, so that's one context. But this LTCG final understanding on equity shares and on all the mutual fund inflows that this market was getting. Now, there's tax on, you know, not just the capital gains, but also on the dividends that will be distributed. So, do you think the market's reaction will play out in the next 1 hour, or will there be residual reaction in the days to come?
There will be residual reaction, Surabhi, but, you know, this grandfathering, of course, has, you know, prevented this market from having a bigger fall.
A huge fall.
You know, the market will have to live with the fact that now there's going to be long-term capital gains tax. I remember when the short-term capital gains tax was increased from 10% to 15%, there was some disappointment for 1 or 2 days. Mm. Life moved on. I think life will move on. And I think in that, maybe you'll have to give credit to Prime Minister Modi. I mean, if he's thought he'll do it, he'll do it. And maybe if it means calling the bluff of the stock market, so be it. But also keep in mind, today is the weekly options expiry as well on the Bank Nifty. So that's why, you know, seeing a bit of a volatility. But interesting day so far. And of course, huge volumes. But we'll find out, you know, how much impact market will have over the next 3 or 4 days. Today, I think, would be may not be the best idea to look at the market and say that, okay, this is market's verdict. But let's get some strategies going for last hour, because it is a crucial last hour. We have Ashwini Gujral and, of course, Sudarshan Sukhani joining us now. Good afternoon. Ashwini, bit of a sell-off from the high point, been very volatile. Your thoughts, and how would you trade the last hour?
First of all, let me say I'm very happy with the long-term capital gains tax.
That
I've
was
been
always
demanding
your position.
It for a long time.
Yes, of course, Ashwini.
Still not level playing field, but hopefully it'll go up next year. For the moment, you know, to say that market hasn't understood the tax and maybe tomorrow it will understand and day after tomorrow it will understand, we would have been down 200 Nifty, maybe 600 Bank Nifty on another day. This sort of mild, muted reaction only means that the bad news has been discounted and taken very well by the market. Bit of volatility up and down, but nothing severe. So chances are we will soon get back towards fresh highs, and that is the position people should take on this, because if whatever reaction had to come, it would have come. I don't think it would have waited. As far as individual stocks are concerned, Escorts is a buy with a stop of 868, target of 900. Rural type of budgets or rural stocks, Aarti Industries is a buy with a stop of 1075, target of 1140. And Manappuram is a buy with a stop of 112, target of 124. And also today's low now becomes very crucial, because it will take some breaking. I think the low was 10,900 thereabouts. So a higher low is now in place, and that should create a base for a further rally.
Okay. I just want to put one point on board, because I was sitting with a whole bunch of taxation experts. The fine print, Anuj, seems to be suggesting that you can keep selling till 31st of March. The new taxation regime is going to kick in from the 1st of April. So if you want to book all your capital gains, and if you want to up your base price, whether it's your NAVs, mutual funds, or your shares, you can still do that.
You can still do that.
But there's the cutoff, the grandfathering cutoff of 31st January.
Yeah, so yeah, that point, of course. So obviously it's been allowed in a calibrated. You know, I think the ministry and you know, obviously secretaries know that. I mean, you can't just say that from today, you know, it applies, and you know, the market would have been circuit down if that was the case. So I think I take your point on that. By the way, I was on Awaz and I was talking to Hasmukh Adia, and the feeling I got was that this is a starter. They want to make sure that there's a level playing field, and just like debt mutual fund are tracked with indexation, because the point here is that you're taxing the short-term capital gains tax at 15%, you're taxing long-term capital gains tax at 10% without indexation benefit. So what you're doing is you are making short-term as attractive as long-term, you know. So in that case, are you giving traders, you know,
an incentive to sort of churn more and to perhaps trade
to churn
and
more
invest.
And to trade more compared to, you know, invest more. Yeah. And I think on that, this is just a start. And over the next 2 or 3 years, the plan is to have a bit of a level playing field for both of that. So that's something we'll find out. But let's take some more strategies then. Sudarshan, you have last hour strategy for the market, or would you want to avoid the last hour trading for now?
Yeah, good afternoon. No, there is no reason to avoid. The market is in an uptrend, and you forget the volatility that we saw, and that happens on every news event. That uptrend is intact. We've had that big news event, capital gains tax, and the market has not even budged a bit. So this market is, I hope and I assume, is going up. The 5 days trading range we saw was actually a correction. So a market that corrects in a range and doesn't fall down is a very strong market. So not only should traders be long in the Nifty, that was the suggestion in the morning, buy calls, that suggestion still remains. You haven't got it, buy 11,000 calls and try to buy good quality stocks. So I have a list of stocks. TCS is a buying opportunity. The stock is now on the verge of a new breakout to a lifetime new high. You want to be in it. These are all overnight trades. Bajaj Auto is a buy. A very attractive bullish head and shoulder is breaking today on the upside, confirming that pattern. So that's something you want again. And finally, among the banks, Yes Bank is a buying opportunity. A small flag has been broken on the upside. My own sense, and I have been repeating it, that this market is only going in a range as a correction, and higher levels are coming, and that sense remains.
Okay, still weakness and more weakness, obviously, on the mid-caps even today. That's been the trend of this week, and that continues even in the post-budget trade. Some more ideas then. We also have Mitesh with us this afternoon. Mitesh, so, you know, what are you working with? Last hour, what are the strategies?
Good afternoon. I think I still have two buy calls. Mahindra and Mahindra, and that's been a recommendation for the last few days. I think now, post the event, firmly established a breakout about 775, 780. So that's the buy. Keep a stop loss at about levels of 774, buy for targets of 830. And amongst the tire stocks, and they are also doing well, JK Tires is something which is of interest. Buy with a stop below 180, look for targets close to about 205.
Okay, well, Nilesh is, of course, still with us in our studio. So, Nilesh, before we thank you, thoughts on whether equity will still remain the preferred asset class? Because now you have tax on equity mutual fund as well. The debate here now is that would some money which has been coming via the SIP route, would that look at some other avenues now? You think that has no alternative for now and the retail flows will continue?
No, I think on a risk-adjusted basis, equity will still looks very, very strong. I mean, I think as an asset class, because, you know, the best other competing asset class, which is, for example, bank fixed deposit or something like that, at best what you will get is 5, 6, 7%. Mm. Versus that, even if equity provides you north of 10, 12%, that's still a fantastic return to kind of live with. So I really don't think that this LTCG of 10% would in any manner be a dampener. So that's one. Two is that, look, when you're holding mutual fund units, it's only when you sell that will you get that 10%. Unlike stocks, when you directly sell, you will have to pay that 10%. So I actually believe that you'd see a lot more stickier allocation to mutual funds versus direct shares. Mm-hmm. And to that extent, I think that's a big positive for this market.
Okay. Ajay, this market has been heavy, and a lot of people are saying that the mid-cap correction that we have seen may actually have had no relation with the budget, and this would have happened regardless. But your thoughts, we have underperformed emerging markets this year and significantly, despite this 4.5% rally, and the mid-cap index is actually down about 4% from the highs. Do you see more mid-cap accidents? We have seen a couple of cases in the past already over the last 2 or 3 days. Wakrangi is a case in point. But do you see more such cases going forward?
Of course, I think you nailed it correctly. I think we'll see much more corrections as we go forward. Market is volatile. Lots of money has moved to large cap, which is the right thing to do when you seek safety. You move to large caps, which the market is doing this point of time. Let's also not forget the fact that we are into an election year where this budget was focused on the sections which are really angry with the government, which are the MSME, the rural India, etc., etc. And this will now have overhang as the time goes by. So if you're looking at investment in the current year, you cannot divorce the political reality of an election in Rajasthan just now, which I believe the Congress just won it. I think that's going to play heavily on the mind of market as well as people, as well as the policy makers, as to what they need to do now to correct it. This budget was focused on that. Well, it should have some results for that one. So, you know, when you go into a year like this, you need to start paring down your investment to much riskier stocks as time goes by. Nobody says you sell off today, you sell off tomorrow. You sell off all these stocks over time, and then you migrate to things like HDFC, HDFC banking, the whole banking sector, the L&Ts of the world, etc., and seek safety there. I think that's where we'll see the mood of the market in the next couple of months is move to more and more safety, and they will walk away from more and more from the mid-cap. The second is liquidity. When people wanted to get out in the last couple of weeks on mid-caps, it was so difficult for them to get out. There's stories of investors, lower fees, volumes are not there, etc. So I think what will happen from now till the next 3 months, lots of the stock will see severe corrections because every opportunity of a price increase in mid-cap will be sold into. Every opportunity will be made to transfer money from this to the large caps. And we still need to read the fine print of what's happening. But on the custom side, a lot of movement into stocks, including today, which will be where the custom duty has gone up. So I think the three clear movements we can see in the market, but distinctly we will see equity investment in mutual funds slowing down by June, July as election approaches. And these results are not going to give greater comfort to investors to pour in more money in the second half of the year.
All right, Ajay, thanks a lot for your patience and your time today. I will keep talking to you, of course. For now, we have Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog, now joining us. Mr. Rajiv Kumar, good afternoon. Your first thoughts on the budget and the question that I have for you. The finance minister spoke about the minimum support price being 1.5 times of the cost. The onus is on Niti Aayog if the market price is lower than that to ensure that happens. So your thought process on that.
Yeah, so to begin with, I must confess that I'm been very pleasantly surprised with, by the budget's focus on growth and to the extent that the finance minister has has sort of allowed the fiscal consolidation process to take a pause, and this is what was needed at this time to push growth and employment and to put India on an 8% growth trajectory. On the agricultural package that has been announced, we should look at it all together. For the first time, I think ever, the holistic picture and the whole rural sector, the rural livelihood, has been taken together, for which the finance minister has announced a package of 14.34 lakh crores. MSP is a very important part of assuring the farmer that his stress is being addressed. So assuring that to be 1.5 times the cost of production is a necessary condition for that. But then along with that has come all other things like clusters, farmers clusters, mega parks, ENAMs, connection to the agro-processing, the value chains. On the specific issue of how would we handle situations where market prices are below the MSPs, the fact is that most of these MSPs don't have a cap on how much they should be procuring. So we can, one, make sure that whatever is brought to the market is procured. And there the Niti Aayog will come up with this scheme of how tenant farmers could be better, better taken care of by the procurement agencies and the banking sector. And that we will do that very soon. And we'll also examine the programs that have been implemented in Madhya Pradesh, for example, and a couple of other states to see how effective they can be in the rest of the country. So, but the overall thrust of the budget in transforming the agricultural sector and yank it out of its backwardness and double the farmers' income, I think is one of the very big features of this agriculture.
Okay, so thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kumar. Thanks very much for your comments and your thoughts. Of course, Niti Aayog is going to be working very closely to ensure that those higher MSP prices do sort of get implemented. We have with us Commerce Minister Suresh Prabhu now joining in the conversation. Good afternoon, sir. Many thanks for joining in. As I toss the basic question, your thoughts on the budget, a specific one on this industry-friendly defense procurement policy that the finance minister spoke of. What should we expect this year?
See, this is a very, as you say, already this is one of the most comprehensive budgets.
takes into consideration almost all sections of society on board, addresses all the concerns of today, but also ensures that India's need for tomorrow are also addressed at the same time. Because this is a fiscal consolidation continued for fifth consecutive year. This is a budget in which we are investing huge amount of money for infrastructure. This is a budget in which agriculture, social sectors like healthcare and education, but at the same time ensuring that agriculture's all aspect of agriculture, including marketing part, including pricing part, including the input related issues, all have been addressed at the same time. Defense procurement is one of the very important issue because we have been always been saying that India is one of the largest importers of arms and ammunition. The trend has to change, so we must make more in India. The moment we actually change this procurement policy, that would have a very positive impact on Make in India as well. It will create tremendous amount of jobs downstream, and more importantly, our strategic interests are properly taken care of. Because in the event of any crisis, if you are dependent on imported arms and ammunition, this is not a very healthy thing to do. So therefore, we are really changing the entire paradigm of security-related issues by addressing these concerns.
So, sir, how will, you know, this be different from the existing defense procurement process that we've seen? I mean, will this policy sort of usher in a higher level of PPP? Are you looking at, you know, slightly different forms of tendering? I'm asking from a domestic defense manufacturer's point of view.
So, you know, this is a one more step towards indigenizing more or less all our defense requirement. We are encouraging under Make in India program, which has been on for last 3 years now, asking companies to go and set their manufacturing plants in India. But this is one area in which, unless the defense itself changes the policy in terms of what they purchase, they will actually have a very extremely positive impact. And in fact, a lot of companies globally were waiting for something like this to happen. Therefore, I think it's a very good beginning, and I think we'll now go a long way in ensuring that we'll be able to manufacture more and more in India to take care of our defense requirement.
Mr. Prabhu, let me ask you a quick on investments and exports to help revive growth, sir. What is your own estimation now in terms of what you can do with the global markets recovering? We've continued to underperform on the export front. What is the expectation now, Mr. Prabhu?
Sorry, about what? Hello?
Mr. Prabhu, on the export front, sir, what is your expectation? We've been underperforming on exports. Do you believe that we can now start to pick up on exports, sir?
On?
Exports, sir, on the export growth.
I think the connection...
Shireen, we're having some issues with, correct,
sir,
with that connection.
Sir, why don't you guys ask him the question?
Yeah. Mr. Prabhu, if you can hear me.
Yeah, yeah.
No, so Shireen was asking about the exports.
Agriculture exports.
Yes, exports in general.
Exports.
Sir, the question, I think Shireen has been meaning to ask you about a revival in exports, whether you see that happening, where there's perhaps enough impetus, if at all it was required, via the budget to get the export story back on track, to see those export numbers pick up, merchandise exports.
You know, in fact, as the finance minister himself said in his introductory remarks itself, that a expected rise in the export is about 15%. We have been seeing a gradual increase in exports. For example, in the month of September, there was a rise of almost 30%. Then October was flat, then 27%, then 21%. So we have been seeing a gradual increase in exports. We are now trying to even work on agriculture export, which Finance Minister again mentioned in his budget speech, which already started working on. We'll put a draft export policy in the public domain soon. So I think there are a lot of positive changes happening, which will ensure that in the future, we'll see an export also contributing to this. Even an economic survey talked about export as a possible engine of growth. So that is what we are working on.
Right. Mr. Prabhu, thanks a lot for your time today. Sorry, we got a bad line. But let's move on, because the market right now is seeing a bit of volatility, especially in the mid-cap space. We have Dharmesh Mehta also joining us, MD and CEO of Axis Capital. Dharmesh, good afternoon. So the markets absorbed the blow pretty well, you would say?
I think so. The long-term capital gain tax was coming. So it's not suddenly that you've been shocked.
Yes.
So at least there was a fear of this coming in, and it's finally come true.
Mm-hmm.
So somewhat it was an expected kind of a line, but obviously it's not something which people wished for, mm-hmm. but we have to live with it for another 1 year.
We have to live with it for another 1 year. You know, the market reaction in the mid-cap especially, Dharmesh, because that's where the problem has been. A lot of people thought that, you know, there's been a lot of profit-taking ahead of budget on mid-caps, and that's continued even today as well. So your thoughts on what's happening here?
See, also remember the amount of investment which was coming in the domestic funds, part of them was going to the mid-cap space.
Yes.
Now you also got the domestic funds into the same net. There's a dividend distribution tax added onto it. So you may see some kind of, you know, slowdown in the mutual fund segment. If that happens, obviously the mid-caps will be affected the most. And if you look at the valuation perspective, the large caps are actually fairly valued. So in that sense, people would be focusing more on the large caps now, for playing a safety thing, kind of a game, because you're now back to global volatility, oil prices, which is not under our control. So clearly markets is now looking forward more for safety and defensive rather than aggressive bets.
Okay. Dharmesh, stay on. We have SP Tulsian of SPTulsian.com also now joining us. Mr. Tulsian, good afternoon. Okay, we'll get to Mr. Tulsian in a bit.
So my question to you on this was, I mean, initially, obviously, phone calls have all been made. Everybody's wondering, the one question on everyone's mind is, will mutual funds see a little bit of a let up of those inflows? I mean, that big monthly figure that we were getting. And then what next for this market? Because those flows have been extremely important in, you know, our journey till 11,000.
And especially coming in this year, which I believe will be the largest fundraising year for India. So in that sense, definitely the domestic flows is needed in a much aggressive manner. So that is the reason I'm a little disappointed with this whole tax thing, because you're not going to gain much, but you're actually going to now put a speed breaker on the equity markets, which was not needed, especially when such a huge amount of divestment target is there, plus money raising is going to happen.
But the other interesting thing, Anujan, your thoughts on this as well. I mean, the market got two blows, right? It got the LTCG blow, and it got another fiscal deficit blow. I mean, if it wanted to react negatively, it could, to 3.3%, because it's a minor sort of a slippage. It's chosen to digest both of these blows very well today, you'd have to say.
Fiscal deficit, I don't think, you know, mattered at all, Surabhi. You know, the kind of conversations that I had with fund managers and market men, because, you know, at the end of the day, it's also a lot about arithmetic. You know, the finance minister is talking about 80,000 crores of divestment, for example, this year. We all know that this year it was 20,000 crore more than budgeted. So, you know, he could spring
that
a surprise.
That is one jugulary, so
exactly.
One cross-holding change, and you can meet the
I think the market was willing to give them benefit of doubt on fiscal, you know, deficit issue. Mm-hmm. That's not a problem. I think the way it's been done, designed, the grandfathering, I think that's allowed this blow to be softened a bit, and that's why I think you're seeing this kind of move on the market.
Sure. Dharmesh, then what next? I mean, we are where we are, as you've been talking about, you know, this discomfort with mid-caps that exists. Let's talk about, let's say, 6 odd months at least for this market. What next?
I think so. Now we're back to the global markets, because India is not a standalone rally. Has been part of the entire emerging market rally, and if you look at entire emerging market this year, India has been a little bit underperforming. So it will all depend on what the global markets happen, especially what happens to oil prices, which is a huge impact on India. If there's a softening of oil prices, India will be safe. But clearly the low-hanging fruit is gone, and now it's going to be tougher to make money in this kind of markets, and especially now where a little bit of the equity mood has been dented. I think so, markets will take a cautious approach going forward.
Okay, stay on, Dharmesh. Sure. Let's go back. Shireen is in conversation with Dharmendra Pradhan, the petroleum minister.
Ultimate consumer. So we should not give any sign, any signal where our reform will be compromised. Simultaneously, we're a consuming country, we're a welfare society. We have to look into our consumer's interests.
Okay.
There are ways and means, and GST is one of the effective way. I think state has to come to this point of agreement.
Okay.
There must be GST in the petroleum product.
There should be GST in the petroleum product. The Ujjwala scheme, the benefits of that have now been extended, sir, from 5 crores to 8 crore households or 8 crore women. You know, how successful has that scheme been? And, you know, what do you foresee in terms of this scheme going forward?
Sirin, this scheme has created new confidence among the poorest of the poor women of the country. This is a new hope. This is a catalyst of social change. Lot of health issues are resolved. Lot of economic issues are answered.
But there has been a controversy on whether they have the ability to get the refills, sir.
Sirin, do you think you and me are consuming 7 cylinders per annum? Do you think they will consume 8 cylinders per annum at the beginning of the year? the average 60% of the new consumer are using 4 cylinder per annum.
Yeah.
This is all the expert of the energy expert of the world are saying, all the health expert of the world are saying, this is an encouraging step.
You're presenting us the Ujjwala scorecard there, but the markets are watching us, sir. So let me once again ask you, because the expectation was that the subsidy bill on account of crude would be at least 30,000 crores, but it's pretty similar to what we saw last year, which is between 24 and 25,000 crores. So what should the markets read into that?
Should it say welcome sign? When my subsidy
be? No going back to a regulated era.
Certainly, government has consciously, the greater interest of this country, to the consumer's interest, we have consciously taken this decision, we will not go to subsidy regime. This is an era of empowerment. Empowerment only can through the market mechanism. More player, more competition, more reduction of price. This is the method.
So the question then is, if you cannot...
Okay, so obviously the point here is, does ONGC have to again subsidize? That was the problem. But anyway, let's do one thing. Let's not take a break right now, because it's the 3 p.m. move could happen on the Bank Nifty, the way things are shaping up right now. And it's again going back into the red for the market. So things looking a bit interesting here. Dharmesh, one pocket of the market where, you know, you've seen some selling today is the PSU banks. And that's been the case for some time now. Your thoughts on what's happening here?
I think so. Mainly people are overexpecting the price where the PSU banks had run up. So you also have to look at the way it had run up also. And there's a freak reaction, maybe short covering. So it actually ran up much more than it should have done. And that's what has been corrected. And to fix those problems is going to take time. It's not going to happen overnight. And especially in a situation when oil prices are rising, it becomes more difficult for the economy to grow that fast as what people expected. So I think so. There was overexpectation when the event happened. And it's just correcting back to the normal levels.
Okay, so we've been talking about how the long-term investors will react to this LTCG. Let's talk to one of them. Rahul Chadha, Chief Investment Officer at Mirae Asset Global, is with us now. Rahul, good afternoon. Thanks a lot for joining us. So the budget is saying 10% long-term capital gains tax. Your thoughts on whether that would impact equity market investments?
I think going into the budget, already expectations were low, market were fearing this tax. This is a bit of a dampener, but beyond a week or two, market would look at the economic recovery, and which is what we as foreign investors would look at this. Look at the story from a medium-term perspective, and the story remains intact, and the recovery is firmly on track. We're seeing earnings upgrades. The earnings season this far till now has been fairly good. So I think the focus again goes back into earnings and valuations. And this would be forgotten in a couple of weeks for now. But for the time being, yeah, it's clearly dampened on the sentiment.
Rahul, afternoon. Do you see any particular sector getting a kicker? I mean, barring a lot of the announcements to rural that came through, I mean, nothing fresh that can spur even more urban consumption. We haven't had that sort of more money in the hands of people sort of a situation play out. So oil and gas, we were just discussing, little muddled given the way the subsidies have been priced in. So is there any specific sector that you think stands to benefit from this budget?
We've seen government kind of increase the spends for infrastructure sector by about 20%. Look, it's all a question of implementation. And I think that's something which is significantly picked up under this government over the last couple of years. Budgets were always there, but they were never really fully utilized. And that's what we are seeing happen over the last couple of quarters. And it's going to happen all the more in the run-up to the general elections in 2019. Rural spends are clearly positive. Again, the story with the government's been all about productivity improvement, whether it's through electrification, infrastructure rollout, or financial inclusion. So I think all that we see is continuation of same. And outside that is a normal recovery in economy. So as nominal GDP grows, it benefits revenue growth. And you're going to see improved utilizations across sectors, basically.
Okay, I tell you something. The 3 p.m. move is happening now on the Bank Nifty on the way down. 27,300 has just been breached. It will be interesting if we make a move towards 27,250 thereabout, because 27,200 put has a lot of open interest that today's strike. So if this mark goes, in that case, there could be some problem. Prakash Diwani is also with us. SP Tulsiyan also with us. Mr. Tulsiyan, good afternoon. Your thoughts on the, you know, top winner and top loser as far as the budget is concerned?
See, Anuj, if I go by sector-wise, I don't see much loser except for the bank and the telecom. If I just say for the banks, for the simple reason that the budget has said that 25% of the debt requirement should be met by the large corporates by the debt. And if that really happens, though, you know, I don't think that that can really take off in the next 6 months. So if that happens, then that will definitely be putting pressure on the credit growth of the PSU bank largely, you know, not on the so much on the private sector bank. Coming on telecom, I don't think that any specific reference, the usual problem of the telecom sector continues, nothing to do with budget. But if I come quickly on the positives, you know, which will be seen having beneficiary from this budget, will be steel and cement from the affordable housing scheme and infrastructure, major thrust having given. Maybe again, agrochemical and complex fertilizer, because again, in the same space, we have seen MSP being placed at 150% of the cost, then housing finance, again, with the affordable housing scheme theme, and then MSME-oriented NBFCs, because if you see the tax rate having reduced to 25% of the income tax rate has been reduced to 25% for MSME, those having turnover or income of up to 250 crore. So definitely they will go and borrow, and there are three or four NBFCs, you know, which are more catering to the MSME, and that will really be seen the beneficiary. Then you have auto ancillaries, defense, housing finance companies, and again the realty stocks, aviation and capital goods. I think these are the broad sectors which will be seen quite beneficiary of this budget.
Okay. Dharmesh, the point on oil and gas, and really, I mean, how do you look at these companies? Because the math hasn't been spelled out clearly in the budget. We're going to keep guessing, you know, whether it's there'll be an excise change at some point in the future. They haven't told us at what price of crude are they factoring in while doing the numbers. So downstream as well as upstream, your thoughts?
Well, as I said, we'll have to see the details when it comes out. Mm-hmm. But primarily, one thing is very clear, there's not too much room for them to raise the prices for the domestic consumer. So somebody will have to bear that brunt in case if oil prices continue to go north. And that actually is a dampener for the entire sector. And ultimately, somebody will have to bail them out.
So will this pocket become a bit of a sort of a no-go, you think?
And you've seen in the past, you know, as soon as oil crosses $70, $80, is when suddenly people, ultimately, it is a company which have to compensate for it. So clearly, it's a negative.
Okay. Okay. Rahul, you know, same question to you, because, you know, for a while, it looked like at least the downstream sector was one clear investment play. There was deregulation in all products. And after that, we saw that big rally. These stocks were undervalued. Do you think this is once again a bit of murky play here? You know, both upstream, downstream, and now with all these mergers, etc., also between companies, do you think it's an area where you would not want to invest right now?
Yeah, I think clearly investors would take a wait and watch approach here. Like the way you said, I think selling government stake in one entity, HPCL, to ONGC doesn't really help the cause, because you know it's done to meet the divestment targets. On top of that, if these companies are not allowed free pricing, that would be again a dampener for this. I think something which government has room to do is reduce some of the duties. If we were looking at the numbers, if you look at diesel duties in 2007, 2008 was somewhere around 5 rupees a litre. They've gone to 15 rupees. Same thing has happened with petrol, where the duties have gone up from 14 to 19 rupees a litre. Now, look, it helps the fiscal revenues, but somewhere government's got to take the call that they can't have their cake and eat it too. So these companies have to be allowed fair profitability if they want investors to be interested in the stocks. And at the same time, consumer cannot bear any more of the price increases. So somewhere, government's got to cut the duties. And that's where somewhere, if you look at the budget assumptions on the revenue growth side of 17%, they look a bit aggressive. So if the normal GDP doesn't pick up as strongly as expected, if the GST revenues don't come as strongly as expected, I think it would be tough to meet the fiscal deficit numbers.
Okay, so still looking at an absolute flat screen as far as the Nifty is concerned. Sensex also about 36 points lower. And the sluggishness on the mid-caps is still well and truly on. Prakash Diwan also joins in the conversation now. Prakash, now, since rural is the focus, if someone does want to play this theme, how best do you think that can be done? Should you stick to, let's say, two-wheeler stocks? Should you look at playing this through FMCG? Or would you go in for specific agri companies? If you could give examples there, then.
Right. So you know, the way the tone of the announcements on the additional expenditure that could find its way towards the agri sector. Seems that you'll have direct beneficiaries, you know, amongst the companies that would benefit, you know, would be the first to take off rather than the two-wheelers and all, which happens more once people in the rural economy consume and spend and stuff like that. So I would you know, in the first round, look at companies like Godrej Agrovet. Very clearly, I mean, it's a portfolio that's remarkably focused onto the agri and the rural side. You look at, you know, companies which supply a lot of tools and equipments to these, so the tractor makers, the tillers, all of that is definitely up and moving. And of course, you know, with the consumption of fertilizer, because of the MSP changes that on particularly some of the kharif crops, you'll find that to be a very distinct change in terms of visibility of earnings for the rural economy. So, you know, that's where, you know, fertilizer spends, complex fertilizer, which typically have been on the back seat and it's urea that dominates, that could kind of, the balance could start tilting in favor of complex fertilizers again. So I think the spending will probably be in very distinct pockets now. It's not an all-round growth that you're going to see suddenly in 6 months and then things would change dramatically. And it's safer to be with the likes of ITC and, you know, which have the handle in, onto all these things.
Okay, I'll tell you something. Right now, it's not safe to be with the banks. The Bank Nifty has taken a big tumble. This, of course, could be because of weekly options expiry as well. 27,300 is now gone. And by some distance, and now we are making a move towards 27,200 as well. So just don't lose sight of the Bank Nifty's intraday chart. Let me just pull out some of the stocks. ICICI Bank clearly is ending at the low point of the day, and that stock right now off about 2%. And of course, HDFC Bank as well moving towards a low point. Now it's interesting, actually, it's turning into a bit of a bigger move on the Bank Nifty. It will be interesting to see if 27,200 also holds. Ashwini, making a move towards the low point on the Bank Nifty. Your thoughts?
See, Bank Nifty range has been 27,200 to about 27,650. Mm. So we've tested both ends of the range. Mm. Now, you know, today there is too much flux. So I would think you will get a better sense maybe tomorrow because once the fine print, etc. is out and analyzed, maybe then it'll be better to take that call, because whether it's because of fine print or because of, you know, expiry, that's tough to say. But today, I think it's too much volatility and just short and long positions getting squared up.
Oh, yes. 27,200 also gone intraday, but now making a move back towards that. Okay, 27,198 now, and still about 20 minutes left to go. So could be quite interesting. In fact, now the Bank Nifty. But, you know, Mr. Tulsian, amidst all this, MRF's numbers came, and that stock right now is at the high point. Did you manage to take a look at the numbers? Because there was a big surge in the stock.
Yes, Anuj, numbers indeed have come out very well. And in fact, if you have just quickly take a call on the EPS for only EPS of 800 for Q3 against 700 of Q2, that itself, you know, indicates that there has been improvement. In fact, the top line has not grew so much, from 3660 to 3844, but a margins expansion has seen there, you know, PBT having risen from 440 crore to 513 crore. So numbers are looking good, but the stock is also looking quite expensive now at the current valuations.
Rahul, you know, your thoughts on mid-caps, and we've been sort of having this debate for several days now. Even as I look at the screen today, even marquee names, I mean, names like Titan, Sundaram Finance, I mean, these are well-established brands and companies. The pressure is beginning to creep in even here. What is your sense with what's happening in the mid-cap market?
Look, we've been talking about this, that since May, June onwards, mid-caps were looking expensive. And what we saw was some of the mid-cap funds had inflows, and which is where these stocks touched new highs. But last 3 months, we've seen mid-caps kind of underperform the large caps. Some of these names like Titan, you said, they're no longer mid caps. In fact, if you look at market caps, they classify as large caps. But look, this is something which is going to happen over next 12, 18 months. As you see global liquidity being withdrawn, as you see rates go up globally, including in India, you will see some of these mid caps, small caps lag the large cap basket where there is more value, basically.
All right, Rahul, we let you go on that note. Thanks a lot for taking time out for us on this important day. We'll take a break and we'll come back with the final closing for the market. It's trying to stabilize. It's a bit of a two-dimensional story. The Nifty is still flat, but the Bank Nifty and the mid-caps are the ones where we have seen bigger damage. So we'll come back and, of course, track market closing for you.